We were promised some water. And I think that is being taken care of. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, a warm welcome to you all. We have three beautiful writers and a very difficult theme, how do societies deal with the dark pages of their history. My name is Anil Ramdas. I myself am from Suriname, and in 1982, the leader of the army killed 15 intellectuals and wiped a few villages from the earth. There is some kind of trial going on, but all the witnesses seem to die naturally or unnaturally. And there's no truth commission in Suriname, but the leader of the army did apologize. And then we elected him as president. Strange things happen in this world. But let me introduce our guests. We have Laila Chidori from Indonesia, Kopano Matlava from South Africa, and Adrian van Dis from Holland. Welcome, all of you. Laila, you were born in Indonesia in 1962. You studied philosophy and political sciences in Canada. You write about the self-determination of women in the confrontation between tradition and modernity. How would you describe the role, the position of women in traditional society?
Maybe I would say that it's more changing society rather than traditional society. Yeah. I think the main problem is because Indonesia consists of variety or many hundreds of ethnic groups and beliefs, and then we try to unite it with one language, Bahasa Indonesia, but then there's this belief that we are part of the East, so everything has to go according to the Eastern submission. So that's one of the things. It's not everything, but that's one of the things that I write, that women still have problems.
What does Eastern submission really mean?
Well, you can go to school, you get your education and everything, but at the end of the day, if you get married, you're still a wife and the mother first, and then second, whatever you are, journalist or doctor.
Your career will be on a second stage.
Exactly, but it's not really written or anything. They just expect you to do. And I'm sure it's not only Indonesia, in other society too. And it's not really taught to you like that, but it's just they expect you to act that way. Mm-hmm. If you put importance.
But when you talk about they, who is they? Is that do you mean they the male people, or do you mean they as the women
society.
Themselves?
I think it's both.
So the women accept their positions.
Some of them, and some of them expect the children to be like that. But I think like my family would be an exception. And then a lot of people in the big cities are exceptions. But
why is your family an exception?
I don't know. I think
you have a very liberated father, or
yeah. Well, they were educated here in Holland, but I don't think that's the only reason. Because my father come from a very very religious family, but then and then he met my mother here in Holland, and they were both educated in Amsterdam. I think partly because I think that's the way they are, but it's also the education. And but when they came back, they have some problem, a little bit of problems because of their attitude towards how they raised us, the kids, and how free we were. Like we don't really have to pray five times a day, like the rest of the Muslim family, and we have choices, like who are we gonna marry and everything. Mm-hmm. So that's a little bit exception compared to the other families.
Okay, and then the Indonesia is modernizing. Maybe you are one of the examples of modernization. And normally, when I travel through Asia, I notice that modernization is nothing else than people having iPhones and other electronic gadgets, while social relations basically stay the same. How do you see that in Indonesia? How is that different?
Yes, we were talking about middle class in Indonesia. It's one of the hard topic because middle class is always considered as the group of people who can make a change. During Suharto's time, we expect that the middle class would do something. And the problem is middle upper class in Indonesia, it's measured by what you mentioned, you know, phone. Well, during those times, there's no mobile phone, but, you know, cars and properties and everything. Whereas I think it has to come also with the education, intellectual, the realization that there's something wrong with the country. So this middle class in Indonesia, I think at the moment, until now, it's still, I don't want to say fake, but it's in the superficial level.
What do you mean, superficial level? The question was whether the social relations deeply between men and women, of course, one of the most important forms of relation, whether that is changing.
In a superficial level, I think. For example, you can be educated, but I think at the end of the day, it doesn't matter your husband who your husband is. They still expect you to serve and to not maybe not like women 100 years ago, but they still expect you to stay at home, or if you work maybe part time, and the kids is it's only your duty. It's not my duty, and I think it's still the same.
It's a strange thing is that I knew a family in India, the man and the woman, they were both professors in sociology, and the man was working in Delhi and the woman was working in Malaysia. And when I met them, when I was asked for them for dinner, he sat down and I sat down and she was serving us.
Mm-hmm. And she's a professor.
And she's also a professor. Yeah. So is that the superficiality you mean?
Yeah, that's what I meant. Yeah.
And then you try to do something about it in your writing. Do you consider yourself a feminist writer?
I'm not really into labels, but people said that I am. And that's fine for me.
That's a really strange answer.
Well, because there's this label of women writers, and then feminist writers, and then urban writer. I mean, there's a lot of labels. And at the end, you know, for me, I'm a writer. You know, but if they want to call me feminist writer, that's fine, because I've been invited to so many festivals and women writers festival and feminist writers festival. That's okay, you know.
Okay, so there's one question I will ask all the writers. Saul Bellow once said that people write for two reasons. There's a confession and reflection. And then there is a self-therapy, which he considers to be the only good reason to write. Why do you write?
I think both of the...
No, don't tell me both of them.
That's okay. I met him, actually. He came to Indonesia.
he told you.
No. It's just I can imagine he say things like that. But... Well, because it depends, you know. A lot of times, maybe being in Indonesia, the second one is usually
the therapy one.
Yeah, it works for me. And again, the reason why I didn't want to label myself as feminist or whatever, because I don't want to consider myself as a victim, like, oh, I'm a woman and, you know, I'm a wife, and later on I'll say that I'm a divorcee. I mean, you know, it feels like I'm a victim, and I don't want that. You know, I don't want that. I'm a writer, that's all. Mm-hmm. I'm a mother, yeah. I'm a journalist. But I don't like all these.
Don't want to be the sad person.
Yeah, ridiculous.
Okay, so. Well, people say that writers from the South or non-Western countries or third world countries, I don't know how to call them, but are more politically motivated, while writers from the West, Western writers, are more psychologically oriented. What's your opinion on this?
Actually, you really should ask people who have read my books, because a lot of them are actually...
You wrote them, so I can ask you.
A lot of them are very psychologically motivated, but it's true.
But that's what I felt when I read scripts, parts of your book which are translated. Mm-hmm. They were really more psychological, and
exactly.
In that sense, very different from what I normally expect from, you know, third world writers.
Yeah. But I agree that the political situation and the social situation usually becomes the background of my stories. But I prefer to write how the characters react towards the environment and towards the political situation. It's more important to me to talk about the individual, not about the coup d'etat or everything. That's important only when it comes
for
the character, exactly.
The environment in which the character is being
defined. Like the story that I'm going to read later.
Yes, I would ask you to read
it now. That has something to do a lot with the political situation in Indonesia, the 74 riots, when there was demonstration against the Japanese goods, and there was also about the Dutch, because it's talking about the parents' generation. So there's a lot of political thing too, but I didn't really talk about the politics. I talked about the characters and how they react to that, and how they try to survive. And that's it, but I prefer
how the political environment penetrates their
their
motives and their deeds.
And towards each other.
Okay, please, I would ask you to read something.
Oh, okay.
Didn't you expect that?
Okay. Thank you. Oh, sorry.
Oh, yes.
I'm just going to give a little bit of context of this story. This is Nine Stories of Nadira. Nadira is the main character. And she's a journalist, she's a daughter, a wife, a mother. And the story that I'm going to write is the first one, the first chapter, when Nadira found her mother's body. Her mother committed suicide. And after this death, Nadira's mother's death, it opens a lot of things about her parents' past, including during the Dutch colonization and how they met in Amsterdam and how different they are. The father comes from a very religious family and the mother comes from a very rich family. Mencari seikat seruni. Inikah hari terbaik bertemu denganmu? Jakarta tidak memiliki bunga seruni. Tetapi aku akan mencarinya sampai ke ujung dunia agar ibu bisa mengatupkan matanya dengan tenang. Ibu selalu berkata, jika dia mati, dia tahu apa yang akan terjadi. Yunina akan menangis tersedu-sedu. Mungkin dia akan melolong. Kang Arya akan membacakan surat Yasin dengan suara tertahan sembari mencoba mengusir air matanya. Aku akan melakukan segala yang paling pragmatis yang tak terpikirkan oleh mereka yang tengah berkabung. Melapor kepada Pak RT, mengurus tanah pemakaman, mencari mukena, mengatur menu makanan dan botol air mineral untuk tamu, dan sekalian mencari kain batik. Terakhir, yang paling penting, yang selalu disebut-sebut ibu, aku pasti mengais-ngais mencari bunga kesukaan ibu yang sulit dicari di Indonesia, bunga seruni putih. Dia tidak menyebut melati, juga bukan mawar merah dan putih, harus seruni berwarna putih.
kenapa seruni? Dan kenapa harus putih? Ibu tidak menjawab, dan aku tak mendesaknya. Ramalan ibu tepat, itulah yang memang terjadi. Kami menemui ibu yang sudah membiru. Wajahnya membiru, bibirnya biru keunguan yang mengeluarkan busa putih. Di atas lantai yang licin itu, aku tak yakin apakah ibu terlihat lega karena bisa mengatupkan matanya atau karena dia kedinginan. Kami menemukan sebuah sosok yang telentang bukan karena sakit atau terjatuh, tetapi karena dia memutuskan hari ini aku bisa mati. Mungkin ibu pernah atau tak pernah berbahagia. Atau mungkin dia merasa hidupnya memang sudah selesai hingga sini. Kang Arya memeluk tubuh dingin itu tanpa suara. Aku hanya menutup mulut, sementara hatiku ribut, tanganku sibuk. Aku menutup segala pertanyaanku dengan pragmatisme. Bagaimana caranya mengangkat tubuh ibu dari lantai itu agar ayah tidak melihat keadaan ibu yang serba biru? Jangan sampai ayah melihat bahwa ini sebuah pernyataan dari ibu. Selain itu, ibu harus segera diangkat karena dia pasti kedinginan. Lihat, warna biru itu semakin lama semakin ungu kekuningan. Sayup-sayup ku dengar suara ibu. Hari ini aku ingin mati. Untuk sementara aku merasakan ada ombak yang bergulung menyesak dada, tapi aku memiliki kekuatan yang luar biasa untuk mengunci gudang air mataku. Aku memiliki kemampuan menekan kepedihan terberat apapun agar hari yang penuh luka ini bisa segera selesai. Sementara aku sibuk bertanya-tanya kenapa ibuku memutuskan meninggalkan kami, tiba-tiba kulihat Yunina menyeruak dari kerumunan kami. Dia mengusir-ngusir tangan yang menghalanginya. Astaga! Tubuh sekecil Yunina bisa mendorong tangan para paman dan bibi yang sudah ikut berkerumun. Yunina menyerbu tubuh ibu yang telentang, tubuh ibu yang sudah diam dan tetap berwarna biru. Yunina melolong, tapi suaranya tak pernah keluar. Namun aku bisa mendengar lolongan Yunina hingga hari ini.
Wonderful, and it's an example of what you just said, that it's much more psychological, actually very universal. Mm-hmm. This could have happened anywhere in the world, right? It could have happened in Alaska, it could have happened in...
I think so. it's a family story.
Yes, but then how does the Indonesian context, the Indonesian experience enter your writing? Not just because of what the part you read, but in general. Does it have something to do? Are you influenced? I'm trying to force you into the subject.
Yes, right? I know.
But then, I think Indonesia is one of those tragic countries where there was this great euphoria during independence, then there was this massacre in 1965, and then there were different times where the country was in complete turmoil and complete in disaster. Do you permit those circumstances, those influences into your stories, or do you keep them out? Like,
No. I'm a journalist. I cannot just ignore the history, the pain, the everything that happened. It's more difficult for me for the 1945 because I didn't experience it. Of course, as a writer, you have to imagine that. Mm-hmm. But for example, the 1965, I was 3 years old that time, but the effect, it's still strong even until now. Maybe you will disagree later because Indonesians usually forget their history, but as a journalist in Tempo where I work, every year, September 30th, we always have to write about what happened from every angle. And one of the things that we wrote around 10 years ago was about how the family tried to survive during the 32 years of terrible administration of Suharto. Mm-hmm. You know, the kids who don't know anything, the kids of members of Communist Party or just the family, or maybe, you know, a really, really extended family who do not know, who didn't know anything. They were all arrested and they were all tortured and everything. So we interviewed them again, and then it was a lesson for us to understand. And
try to get those stories alive again.
Yes, yes. And right now, my novel, my unending novel, it's been 5 years. It's talking about that, the generation after. Yeah, not the parents, but the generation who really didn't understand what was going on, but they also got the punishment from the government. Like, they cannot get a job, they're not allowed to, you know, they have to change their names, you know, because if you are the son or the daughter of the communist member, and then you cannot get a job.
Still.
Well, not anymore now, because now it's, you know, it's a reform time.
Yes.
But it was during the 32 years.
Yes, okay. Yeah. Thank you very much. Leyla Chidouri, thank you. Her book in Bahasa, the last book, is for sale, and her other translated work as well. Thank you very much, Leyla. Our next writer is Kopano Matlava. You are from South Africa, and you were born like yesterday?
No.
In 1985. But you are, as they say, from the Coconut Generation, which is also the title of your first book, Coconut. What does this term mean, actually?
Yeah, this coconut, I don't know who, I've never heard that before until I came to this festival, so it's a new term. My first novel, Coconut, was about identity. It's about coconuts. I'm sure a lot of people have heard that term before, the actual coconuts. It's brown on the inside and brown on the outside and white on the inside, and it's a term commonly used in South Africa as an insult to people, to dub you as a sellout or a fake, or you think you're better. And it's used, many people have called others coconuts and have themselves been coconut, because it depends who you are in reference to. So someone slightly richer than you, you will call a coconut. Someone slightly poorer than you, or politicians often call them each other coconuts. But really what the book was about, it used the title Coconut, but the book was about identity. I was 18 when I started writing it, and that's the time when you try to figure out who you are and your place in the world and what it all means. And I was struggling with these issues. We were educated in English. Many of my friends' parents said, speak English at home. Let's speak English, because you need to be good at English at school. In our own home, my parents spoke to us in Sepedi, my language, and we were free to respond however we chose, and that was what they decided. But, I mean, it wasn't just language. It was the aspiration for the straight hair, the blue eyes, the sharp, pointy nose, the accent. Accents were very important. How
Sorry,
you spoke.
The blue eyes, you said?
Yeah, of course. I mean, there's
it took a while before.
But there's colored contact lenses, and that's common for black people to wear colored contact lenses. That's, I mean, Naomi Campbell. That's not unique to South Africa, but it was something that I was struggling with. What was going to happen to us as a people, to our languages, to our cultures, if my parents pass away, which someday, sadly, they will? Would I be able to conduct a funeral, a wedding? Would I know the rites of passage? And some felt that it wasn't important, that culture's dynamic and it's changing and it's natural. And others felt that it was a tragedy. And here we are as young people, we can't speak to our grandparents, because our grandparents, of course, don't speak English. And so the book explores those issues, issues that are hard to discuss, I mean, and are painful, because our parents meant well. They wanted a good life for us. They and English was that life. But there's a huge loss. I mean, language is more than just words. It's who you are.
So actually, it's about this double bind. I recognize the same kind of double bind when I read all kinds of migrant literatures. It's always about you have to live between two cultures, you travel between two cultures, you have to, at a certain moment, you have to make a choice, and you always feel like it's the wrong choice. You always feel like, you are very self-aware and uncomfortable in both worlds, actually. Is that what you mean?
Definitely. that definitely, and that's what, there's two main characters in the book, and they both experience two different ends of it. One, and both feel not welcome in either world, because they are too black for white and too white for black. And that's a difficult place to find yourself in a country that's very racially charged.
Mm-hmm. But that you will have to find a comfortable space in which you say, well, listen, guys, I'm very sorry, but the culture of my grandparents was great, but I'm not going to be to move forward in that culture. It's beautiful. You should put it in a museum and look at it. But I'm going away.
Well, that's just the question, and that's just the point that we are. What does that even mean? You tell a little black girl looks at herself in the mirror and sees something that is not good enough, that is inferior, that is ugly.
It's not that it's not good enough, but it's not like it's not working for you anymore. I mean, look, you are writing in English, right?
Yes.
And English has been very successful for you. That culture you entered has been very successful for you. So why are you bothered by that other culture you...
Oh, my goodness.
I know.
Well, you see,
this
is why I write about these stuff, because I get so emotional when I try to speak about them. That is just the point, because it's far-reaching effects. And it's. I remember going to university, and I studied medicine, and the marks would come out, and the black pupils would be at the bottom 20%, and the white pupils would be at the top 20%, and they'd be a couple in between. But that was generally the trend. And this is in the New South Africa, where most of us got sort of similar education. And there's always that thing that even though the laws have changed, and we know how to say the right things and the right words, and we're a rainbow nation, that our minds are still shackled to the lessons we were taught in the past, that we will never meet that standard, that it doesn't matter how hard we try, how good your accent is, you will never meet that standard. And I remember a friend saying to me, well, Kopano, I went to a private school and I went and I still struggle. I still get to university and I still do badly. Is it possible that maybe we're just not quite the same? And I was so sad that she could even consider that thought. And these images, watching movies where the black characters are sweeping the floor and tidying up the tables, that as a child you watch that, you watch TV, and there's no role models. How can you be a doctor? Have you ever seen anyone who looks like you be a doctor? Are you crazy? That's not your role. I remember my mom telling me that we went to a mall once when we were little, and my mom dressed us up, and sometimes dressing well was kind of your way of saying, you know, don't look down on me. My mom always dressed us very well, and we were at a supermarket, and this lady came to me and said, your children are so beautiful, they might work for me one day. And my mom was enraged, and these are the messages that you get, and it goes beyond hair and color of your eyes. It's a psychology of a people that doesn't matter that the laws have changed, that we'll never be the same, and Africa will always be the orphan of the world, and we'll always be the begging bowl of society. And that's a horrible message for people to inherit, for children to inherit. And
mm-hmm. And just, I think, wait another 50 years and sell your minerals for a better price.
And maybe that is the era that now we think it's maybe money will solve the solutions, good oil deals might solve our problems, but I think there's a psychology of it that is in our genes,
yeah.
And that needs to be addressed.
For literature, it's a very a great advantage to be in little pieces and to be broken up and to be completely not a whole, because then you have something to write about.
No, I mean, come on,
we don't want to read stories about people who are in the same place all their lives and culturally completely confident and all that crap.
Well, I think it depends why you write.
Saul Bellow's question.
Yeah.
Please, why do you write?
I mean,
Just therapy, or is it just reflection and confession?
I write because I've always written. It's always been a part of my life. My writing was very close to my prayer life. I wrote letters to God when I was a very little girl. I wrote out books. I changed the endings of books, and it's something I've always done. So it's something I grew up doing, and I've continued to do it. And I don't know, I think that's an academic question, whether it's therapy or is it confession. I think writing is something spiritual for me. It's close to my heart. It brings me peace. It brings me joy. It's what I love to do, and that's why I do it.
And quite successfully at it. Thank you. Please. I would like to invite you to read.
Okay. Okay, I'm not going to explain because I'd like to encourage you to buy the book and read, so I'll just start. She pointed out that after the elation, after the hysteria, after the scones and ginger ale and custard and canned peaches, after the delirium and the drama, after the heat and intensity, after the meat and the alcohol and salt and vinegar chips, after excitement pierced the air and prospect ripped the sky, after it all, things came apart. Came apart slowly, but came apart nonetheless. Deceit was found in the pockets of our heroes, rot in the rucksacks of our warriors, treachery in the notepads of our leaders, depravity in the shoes of champions, greed in the closets of the ordinary, decay on the keychains of figureheads, and disease tucked quietly into the bras of our legends. And even the pale people realized that they needn't ever use the just-in-case pack bags they kept underneath the suitcase, in the boots, under the bed, the car they kept with extra fuel, extra oil, extra tires, the apartment they kept in Australia, in London, in New Zealand, because as it so happened, the dark people became their own oppressors. The perilous thing about being the victim, she said, is that you are never forced to hold the mirror up to yourself. No one ever asks you to validate your actions, your motives, your intent. So you continue on with no points checked and no questions asked. And after Utata, well, there really were no great names, not in the moral sense anyway, no nobility left. Sure, there was money and plenty of money makers, but no t-shirts, no funny dance, no million-dollar smile, no croaky voice. And so Muhuma Hadi, because that was how she was to be addressed, called for a school to be formed, Sekolo sa Ditlhora, a school of excellence, a place where mathematics would not simply be a tool taught to tally mortality rates, to compute debts, and to add zeros to falling economies, but a means to add something to the nothingness, to create change, fill space, organize thinking, and multiply results. A place where history would not be a subject of chronicled post-independence dates of resentments, war, and hatred, but would stand as a witness to all things overcome from all centuries gone by. A reminder of where we have been and where we no longer want to be.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, gedane zaken, spilled milk is for sale in front, and please do buy it because it's really very intriguing and a fascinating book. And I have a few questions now for you, but I will just combine them with the questions I'm going to ask Adrian, because actually we are going to talk about the same topic. And
yes, I'm a feminist writer.
You are a feminist writer. All writers should be. It is difficult to ask you introductory questions. I consider you a friend, but still, you have two passions, South Africa and Indonesia. Can you tell us about these two passions, in short?
I'm raised in a family where color played a very important role. Actually, everybody was a bit brown around me. I wanted to be like them. I wanted to be part of the war.
The opposite of what you didn't want to have blue eyes.
Well, I had green eyes, funny enough, but I knew lots of people with blue eyes, the cheeseheads in the village, but they called the people where we lived the blue colony, blue, because of the blue shade and the black hair of the people from Indonesia. But I also wanted to be part of the war. I wanted to be a girl, first and foremost, because there were all girls around, and they had another vocabulary. So I just did not want to be myself. And that's why I started writing.
It worked.
And then
South Africa.
Yes, South Africa came while I was studying Dutch language, and I came across a writer who wrote about color in a peculiar way, in Afrikaans, which is already a language that has a kind of color in it. It's a creolization of the Dutch language, though totally denied during apartheid, but it is. It was founded in the Cape with the imported slaves from West Africa, Madagascar, and the imported Malay slaves from, let's say, the Dutch East Indies. And with the bunch of people that worked for the first multinational VOC, people from Denmark, very few Dutch, by the way, Germans, all cheap labor, you know, in those days. And they made up that language, because you simplify your language when you speak to your slave. Your slave gives the language simplified back to your children. That's how it starts, creolization. Beautiful language. You can really write about the pain and misery and all the beauties of the country in that language, poetically, but also misused as a language of our identity, and that name of that of identity, you are less and we are more. And that intrigued me, because I was raised in a family where this, you are part of it.
But the strange thing is, you were very interested in the language, and not in, you didn't agree with the power relations going with that, with the use of Afrikaans.
Well, it started with beauty, I must say, and I could even say that the most really corrupt and conservative writers wrote perhaps the best poetry. That's already a very confusing thing to discover.
Yeah.
And that in the end, it all means that what counts is just the force of your writing and not your political ideology. Okay. We don't know where writers from the 17th century stand on political way. I mean, his name escapes as a rocket out of my mind. Flaubert was an awful conservative, but a great writer. I mean, what is important, his books, not where he he was against the French Revolution or something like that.
Would you say that you are the opposite of the Copano, white from the outside and black from the inside? You're the opposite of a coconut?
Well,
You see, the first time I wrote about you in a newspaper after you made the first television program, he is famous for his television program, Hier is Adriaan van Dis. And I wrote about the first episode in a paper, and I wrote, good heavens, he is a nigger.
Well, it was a compliment. But it's a bit silly. But I feel very much at home in Africa somehow. I don't know why. And there was a lady in Friesland who was a clairvoyant, how you call that in English, someone who was a soothsayer or something like that. And she said that I was black in my former life, so let's keep it to
you believed
to
her.
That. No, but that's all nonsense. First of all, I always say only 9% of the world is white, and somehow people think that everybody thinks white. But that's quite and when you're raised in a family who has experiences with other religions, who had important positions in another day, in another time, in other countries, then you know that it's not only white, there's more behind the dikes. And that's what I became more or less a topic for writing, to escape from my own cage and to know where are the other people, what are they doing, what are they thinking. Now I live in Paris, it's the biggest African city outside Africa. And it's amazing how migrants from Africa keep their mindset from the 60s, for example, in Paris. If you want to see Dakar 1960, go to Paris. You won't find it in Dakar. The hairdressers do make hairdos you don't find in Dakar nowadays, but you find them in Paris. And that's the same with my family. They kept a kind of Dutch East Indies colonial world in their mindset. India is still alive, but here in The Hague. You won't find it in Indonesia.
Yeah, which makes you quite a cosmopolitan writer, one of the most cosmopolitan writers in Holland, maybe. But let's ask the last question, Saul Bellows. Is writing for you confession and reflection or therapy?
Well,
I think I know the answer, but
if you say therapy, then you think it helps.
Shouldn't help.
Oh no,
therapy never helped anyone.
Well, it's indeed bookkeeping of your own madness, but I like to write, and I'm happy when I write. But as I said, the cage is important to escape from your cage, and when I write, I escape from my cage too. I become someone else, not the one I am, but the one I want to be when I write. So I have been a dog in a book. The Walker is about a dog. And the people, there's also about a very funny man who likes to keep his house tidy, and people think that's you. No, it's not me. I'm the dog. That's the reporter. That's the dog that goes from sensation to sensation, peeing from tree to another sensation.
It sounds like a beautiful life. Please, I would like to invite you to read from Tickle. Oh.
Well, well, well. Stiff old man.
Here. I have to give the context to it's in the Cape, Cape province. I'd have to use some nominations from apartheid, Cape colored. They are not black and they are not white. They're in between. There were days that they want to call themselves black and then suddenly where they're not black enough. And now they don't know what they are, sometimes at least. And it's all situated in a rather suffocating village where fishermen live. And here's this funny white man who tries to speak Afrikaans and tries to listen to what these people tell him. Haar duim wees naar de haven waar de boeien oplichten. Ze was teruggekeerd naar haar geboortedorp, een frot dorp. Voor haar kind, een zoon die haar bestal, een frot zoon. Charmijn, dat was haar Kaapse naam, want ze had eigenlijk een mooiere naam, maar ze had zich heel modern Charmijn genoemd, zoals kinderen vandaag Chantal heten. Charmijn nam een grote slok en hield haar lege glas op. Hij schonk bij, maar durfde niet door te vragen, anders kwam hij nooit van eraf. Bovendien kon hij niet op de juiste woorden komen. Maar Afrikaans is een flauw Europees aftrekseltje pis. Het is niet al te waffers, niet, zei hij. Hij verhaspelde een regel uit een van de gedichten die hij van Donald uit zijn hoofd had moeten leren. Charmijn proestte het uit. Waar had meneer die woorden geleerd? Hij was zeker vaak in Zuid-Afrika geweest. Oh nee, dit was zijn eerste bezoek sinds de bevrijding. Bevrijding? Ze keek hem verbaasd aan. Van wat praat meneer? Wat een bevrijding? Apartheid. Germain trok een vies gezicht. Denkt meneer werkelijk dat we daarvan zijn bevrijd? Ze tastte grommend in de zakken van een rok, een diepte een aansteker en een morsig pakje sigaretten op. De tabak was nat. De aansteker vatte moeizaam vlam. Haar huid lichtte op, bruin met donkere groeven. Een mooi gezicht. Maar vroeger, zei de man. Vroeger? Excuus toch, meneer. Meneer kent toch het onderdorp, dat kommetje, goed genoeg voor bruin. Vroeger zaten er nog lampen in de lantaarns. Vroeger kon je daar als vrouw s'avonds veilig lopen. Vroeger was daar geen kind aan de tik, de drugs. Meneer moest daar eens komen opzoeken. Kon hij zien hoe de mensen daar woonden, zonder behoorlijk riool. De regering luisterde niet naar hun klachten. We zijn niet zwart genoeg. En nou spoelde het regenwater niet meer weg. Met dit weer stond de helft van de huizen blank. Ze was nog een meisje in die tijd, maar één ding wist ze zeker. Vroeger was het beter in haar dorp. Hij schonk haar koffie met 8 scheppen suiker. Mulder hoorde haar uit over haar dorp. Wie er vroeger in zijn huis had gewoond, wanneer de school was afgebrand. Maar Charmijn vermoeide zich niet met feiten. Vroeger was een ander dorp en de zee was toen voller. De rest was te lang geleden. Zelfs de eerste keer dat ze mocht stemmen. Het jaar, de maand, die zon net geschijn. Alleen het weer was blijven hangen, na flink doorvragen. Democratie is niet voor arme mensen, zei ze.
This is astonishing. Copano, you actually, in the part you read, told us about the fact that the victims are also corrupt and cruel and bad, and you even go a step further in suggesting that it was better during apartheid.
I'm not suggesting that.
There's a
few books appeared. Black Nostalgia.
Native
Nostalgia. Mm. About people who think, well, everybody in Holland too, they say it was better in the old days.
Okay, so but then where are we? We all thought that South African liberation was a historic model, that there was no terrible bloodbath, and there was a Truth and Reconciliation Commission with confessions and tears of forgiveness, and all would be good afterwards. Was it all false?
No. It wasn't false, and it certainly, definitely was not better under apartheid.
No.
But the work didn't stop with an election and Mandela and a whole lot of happy pictures and long lines and celebrations. The work had to continue, and unfortunately the work didn't continue. Truth and reconciliation are
what no... What do you mean, of course the work doesn't continue?
No, I said unfortunately the work didn't continue. Truth and reconciliation are noble goals, but they assume integrity of both parties. And we, as a country, could believe that reconciliation was a good thing because Mandela had suffered more, if not the same, as most. So he could suggest that, and people would accept it. But I think what's come up now is that when we have leaders who steal and lie and are greedy, it's difficult to move forward because you feel cheated. You mm-hmm. feel that the story you were told was a lie. And I think that's where things start to come apart. The goals were noble goals and they were goals worth striving for, but there needs to be integrity by all parties who agree to that deal. Okay. And unfortunately, there wasn't integrity on the other side.
Adrian,
and
would
apart
you,
from that, yeah, sorry.
Would you say, as a relative outsider, mm-hmm. that maybe the goals were too high from to begin with? I mean, the whole world expected this country to be the model for betterment for the universe.
Yeah, but the idea that there's confession and that you can tell and talk about all the crimes that happened may be a very liberating thing, but especially liberating for the white people. First, they heard that what happened, things they thought they didn't, well, they didn't want to know it before that, and suddenly they knew it, they had to know it. And but it's not enough, even the things that happened later, because people also need to ventilate their hatred, I'm afraid, their deep frustrations. Mm-hmm. It's not just by a common chatting and public
there's a deep
confessions.
Wound. It has to heal somehow.
It has to, well, we would still talk about the Second World War here. It's still the topic in our literature.
It's good that you
And the South Africans are such a noble people that suddenly, after 2 years of public confessions, they go on and they will be a better people than and be an example in the world.
Or would
not.
Be just
the great thing
as
about South
else.
African people is that they are normal people like everybody else. Hmm.
Okay, well, one last question, because otherwise the organization is going to kick me. If you see how countries deal with their past, it's Indonesia, South Africa, or which other country, sometimes there are trials like the Nuremberg tribunals in the Second World War. Then you have the truth commissions, and then there is the method of the Netherlands and Indonesia and some other countries. Forget about it, let's pretend slavery, colonial massacres, and coup d'etats and mass murders never happened. Which one would you choose?
can I
yes, please.
In Indonesia, the people always talk about, they always look at South African case, you know. And
Truth Commission.
Yes, reconciliation and everything. And Nelson Mandela came to our country and sat down with a lot of intellectuals and members of parliament. And, you know, at that time he just came out from prison, so he's not the leader yet. But you know, people really, really admire with what happened in South Africa. So now I'm kind of down with what you just mentioned.
They are really making us sad. That's true. But
yeah,
but
that's what we felt. It's right for Indonesia.
But
if
I talk from my own view, I don't believe in forgiveness. Neither do I believe in forgetting. Actually, I prefer good history books and novels like you all write.
I mean, it's not my intention to make you sad, but I think it was a brilliant thing, and I think it was necessary, I think it's wonderful that we went through it without bloodshed. But all I'm saying is that it doesn't stop with that, and it needs to continue, and we need to keep talking, which we don't do. We walk on eggshells around each other. We're scared of saying things that might offend another person, and what you're saying, that we need to face it, that we need to say we're angry and that we're disappointed.
Absolutely.
And that you lied to me,
yeah.
And I lied to you,
sure.
And that's not okay. So we can move forward, but we haven't done that. We've kind of shook hands and plastered a smile on our faces and hoped that it would be okay, and of course it won't be okay.
Yeah, well,
like that
means educate, and when you know,
then you have also the possibility to be angry, but perhaps on a better level. Because the thing is that Indonesia people don't know very much about their past. The angry people I met were all in their 80s, who told me that there were only 40 people with an academic, with a university degree in Indonesia in 1945 and a population of 50 million. That's a shame. And when I knew all these things, I got angry, because I didn't know that either. So the more I know, the more upset I am. So what if you say, what is better, to forgive or to forget? Well, to forget, of course, because if you don't know it, then
okay,
you're not
angry. Okay, but on the other hand, on the other hand, writers are not in the business of forgiving. They are in the business of not forgetting.
Indeed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lisa.